I know what you're thinking. How come she got so good at sports? Sadly, the truth is, I could use a little improvement. But believe it or not, you can use math to get better at sports. I'm not talking about cheating, but getting to the core of how sports work and what it means to do well at them. Math and sport might seem like total opposites, but think about it. At heart, sports are kind of like math, paid out in physical form, from the way they're scored to the precise and often beautiful shapes and angles that make up a court or a playing field. Sports involve equations, geometry, percentages, statistics, graphs and tables, and so much more. So how can you use all that math to your advantage? Can you calculate your way to victory? Let's find out. Every sport ever invented involves some kind of movement. Otherwise, you're just playing statues. But what is movement? It's when people or things travel a distance in a certain amount of time. Now, distance and time can both be counted, measured, and described in units. That means we can do math with them. For starters, we can calculate speed. A top athlete can run 100 meters in about 10 seconds. That means their speed is 10 meters per second. So every second on average, they move 10 meters. Speed isn't the only way to describe how things move. We also need to think about direction. But in running, only one direction matters.
Which way is the finish line?
But in many sports, especially those involving a ball, the direction of the ball and the people playing is constantly changing. Okay, so when a ball hits something, whether that's the wall, the floor, or a backboard, it bounces off at an equivalent angle. But while the rebound of a ball off a stationary, flat surface is relatively easy to predict, the angle it moves when it interacts with a complicated shape, like a baseball bat, or a human hand, or a foot, that is also moving, is much more difficult to visualize. Now, when you combine speed and direction of movement, you get trajectory. In theory, if you know where an object is now and how it's moving, you can calculate where it's going to end up and every point in between. Being able to anticipate an object's trajectory is essential to success in baseball, soccer, golf, pretty much every sport. In basketball, trajectory really comes into play when a player makes a shot. Let's say the angle made when a player has their arms extended parallel to the floor is 0 degrees and reaching straight up, 90 degrees. Closer to the basket, she would need a higher throwing angle. And further away, a lower angle. During a basketball game, there's several players on the court, plus a ball, all of them constantly moving at high speed. And every player has to try to track the ever-changing combined trajectories of all of them, in effect making hundreds, maybe thousands of calculations every second. Now, you might be thinking, if sports involve lots of calculations all happening at the same time, couldn't we build a computer or a robot to win at sports? After all, computers are much quicker than us at making complicated calculations and can easily defeat the very best human players in games like chess. But it turns out what comes naturally to us in the physical world remains way beyond the capability of technology. Robots are unbeatable in places like factories, where the work is simple and repetitive. There, their strengths and speed far exceed ours. But sports are unpredictable, exciting, human. The whole point of them is the way that sometimes what we tried to do doesn't turn out to be what we actually do. But one place where computers really excel in sports is crunching data. Let's go dig some up. Sports fans love sharing facts, figures, and statistics. Since the development of modern organised sport in the 19th century, people have enjoyed keeping tracks of all kinds of results, game logs, records, and milestones. We can look back at these records and relive historical sporting moments and see improvements over time. Remember that modern athletes do 100 metres in 10 seconds. But look here, the first modern Olympic champion, Thomas Burke, took 12 seconds to do it in 1896.
Nowadays, he'd be way back in last place.
For a long time, all this data simply piled up. It was great to talk about, but no one thought to use it to find new winning approaches. And late in the 20th century, people had the brilliant idea to use computers to analyse data and fundamentally change how some sports were played. The 2004 book Moneyball, later made into a film, tells the true story of Billy Beane, the general manager of the Oakland Athletics baseball team. He wanted to build a winning team, but the Oakland A's had a small budget compared to the other teams. So instead of relying on old assumptions about how to win, Beane and his assistants used math and statistics to find undervalued players.
So using this equation on the upper left right here, I'm projecting that we need to win at least 99 games in order to make it to the postseason. We need to score at least 814 runs in order to win those games and allow no more than 645 runs. It's about getting things down to one number. Using the stats the way we read them, we'll find value in players that nobody else can see.
They discovered that some statistics were more important than others in predicting a player's performance, and they were able to find players who were talented but undervalued by other teams.
People are overlooked for a variety of biased reasons and perceived flaws. Age, appearance, personality. Bill James and mathematics cut straight through that. Billy, of the 20,000 notable players for us to consider, I believe that there is a championship team of 25 people that we could afford because everyone else in baseball undervalues them. Like an island of misfit toys. Three up on the Angels.
The Athletics started to win more games without spending as much money as the other teams. Moneyball showed how using math to analyze data and make decisions based on those insights can revolutionize sports.
Okay, so how are we going to use all this math to win?
Let's see. First of all, simple principles of math and geometry improve our chance of winning. Isn't that right? Secondly, we pay attention to all this data analysis to find out winning strategies. Thirdly, and most importantly, we use this data analysis to track our own lives, to improve our practice and our progress. Remember, anything that can be measured is data. It could be the number of times a week you manage a practice session, or how many hours of sleep you get, whether you have a fizzy drink at lunchtime or not, even what kind of mood you're in. It's all data. And when you've got data, we can do math. And if we keep track of all your results, how quickly you complete a lap, how accurate your shots are, and keep track of all these other factors, put them in a table, or a pie chart, or a graph, then bit by bit, day by day, you'll start to see patterns. I figure I've got the ball here, and if I time it just right, we might just make it. Let us know in the comments what part of this episode surprised you the most. Don't forget to subscribe, and thanks for watching.
Did you laugh?